I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. Join heirs with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm part of the family of God. Join me in that refrain. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. Join heirs with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm part of the family of God.
Hosanna!
Amen. Welcome to the Church on the Boulevard. It's been kind of a crazy morning here. Satan's been working overtime, but we are not going to give him the victory, and we're not going to give him the opportunity. Amen? Because it's just, we give God the glory, so no matter what you're dealing with today, frustration or just problems, give them to God right now, and let's focus our attention on him, because he can handle everything that is going wrong in our lives right now. So let's have a word of prayer before we continue. God, you are the God who saves us. Through you, we find our strength, and we thank you for the life that you have given us. We praise you and thank you for the freedom to worship you openly and to be able to tell others about your son, Jesus. We ask that you bless this time together this morning. Let all our thoughts be focused on you and your greatness. We pray you would speak through Ron as he brings the message this morning. Help us to know your will for our lives, for it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Psalm 100 reads this: Shout with joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him singing with joy. Acknowledge that the Lord is God. He made us and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Go into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name, for the Lord is good. His unfailing love continues forever, and his faithfulness continues to each generation.
Good morning, everyone. Just before the last song, I was ready to jump up here and do my time because the praise team really gets you excited, really gets you focused on the Lord and how good He is to us. So I'm very thankful for the praise team and their energy for what they do. Today, however, I want to talk about distractions and trying to stay focused. It's really difficult to do this because, well, I'll give you an example. Last night I watched a kid's movie with my grandson. It was a newer one, and the colors were very, very vivid, and things happened like every 3 seconds. I tried to count to three between scene changes, and it never happened. I never got to four. And I think what's happening is that's conditioning us to be distractive, and it harms our ability to listen, to pray, to be still and know that He is God, and to meditate on His Word. And that's why I think studies, home Bible studies, are a great thing because they do cause you to focus on the Lord for 45 minutes to an hour. So this is called a God moment. And of course, a God moment is a very special time that God makes it very clear that he's working in your life. And we need to appreciate these special moments, kind of like a love note from God, but we can't limit it to just those moments in time. As a matter of fact, every activity, every event in our life is a God moment. So instead of scripture, this one song kept rolling over in my head. It's a chorus from a hymn. It says, moment by moment, I'm kept in his love. Moment by moment, I have life from above. Looking till Jesus, till glory doth shine. Moment by moment, O Lord, I am thine. Now, the thing about these moments is we need to be very conscious of how the Lord works in our lives. And not only that, I think we need to write them down or post them on your phone or whatever so you could look at them during the course of the day and also to share them with other Christians. And I think that'll help us keep our eyes focused on him instead of the distractions of the world. Let's pray. Father God, sometimes it's difficult to recognize our distractions until Jesus comes along and helps us see our hearts. And we think we're doing right, but he points out our values, our priorities, when they're not in order. So, Father, I'm sorry that we shift our attention from you and your blessings, all the things around us. Please, Lord, increase our resolve to pursue only what you call us to do and to deliver us from distractions. Strengthen us all to focus our hearts and thoughts on not only furthering your kingdom, but sharing the good news that Jesus saves. In whose precious name we pray. Amen.
Away by the power of your love.
Psalm 5 says this, because of your unfailing love, I can enter your house. I will worship at your temple with deepest awe. Lead me in the right path, O Lord, for my enemies will conquer me. Make your way plain for me to follow.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. And I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken.
Morning. It's good to see everybody here. So the announcements for this week, and everybody wants to get in on the game a little bit today. So Monday is our food pantry. It's an evening food pantry, but it's a morning pickup, kind of, and Carol wants to talk about that. What, you thought I was going to give you a chance to relax? Psst.
Good morning. For those of you that those few of you, I'm going to say that again, the few of you that show up for the pickup, we'll just meet at the church tomorrow morning at 8:30. I got a call on Friday, and they're going to deliver our pickup, which I have to tell you, last Monday, it was a struggle. It's a struggle for me to do physical lifting and stuff here lately. And last Monday, it was hard. But, you know, we had Steve and Miss Kai and Miss Shy, and, you know, there was a little bit of help. Without them, it wouldn't have gotten done. But I honestly, I know that God orchestrated the pickup or the delivery on Monday because of the struggles. So, if nothing else, don't put your faith anywhere else but in God. Because even something so small is not getting worn out from picking up boxes of food. God cares about the smallest of the small. That's all I got. Oh.
And so I have a feeling we're going to run into a theme here. Because Wednesday, of course, we have our grab-and-go dinners. And Michelle, who leads that, says she wants to say a few words.
Morning, everyone. As some of you know, over the last couple months, we have had to cancel some of our community dinners. And the reason why we've had to cancel those community dinners is lack of help. You know, this last Wednesday, Carol texted me, and it was going to be just me and Carol putting together the meal, cooking the meal, and serving. The week before, we had tons of help. What I am asking for is for people to volunteer their time and help us feed this community. You know, we've been doing these community dinners for a good number of years, a lot longer than the pantry's been going, actually. But the thing is, it's our way of reaching out to the community. And in these times especially, people need extra food. They need to have a meal, okay? So I don't want to have to cancel any more dinners. If I have to do it all by myself, I will, because God will help me do it. But I would really like to see some people turn out and volunteer. And what I need from you is, if you feel like volunteering, I'm not asking for you to commit to every single Wednesday. Let me know when you are available to help out at the dinners, whether it's coming in and cooking, helping to, you know, put the meal together. The biggest thing is serving. We need people to be able to hand these meals off to these, you know, to the people that come in from the community. So anyone that feels like they would like to volunteer every now and then, see me after church, and I will give you my number so that you can text me on Wednesday by 2 p.m. to let me know if you're going to be there or not. That way I know how much help we have so that we don't have to cancel any more dinners. It's as simple as that. You know, I know a lot of you volunteer at the food pantry. Help out at the dinners too. We need to be able to continue reaching the community, and this is one of our ways of doing it. So see me after church, and I'll give you my number so you can let me know.
Thanks. And the Wednesday night dinners, I'm there most Wednesday nights. That's it's a good time talking with the community and seeing us being able to feed them. But there seems to be a theme there, right? God calls us to give, and so we need to be giving, not just of money, but of time and talent, right? Time to serve. Next Sunday is a men's breakfast, so of course, tell Brian, biscuits. I don't do the bacon. I eat the bacon, I don't cook the bacon. And then next Sunday is also the card ministry, which is a newer ministry that we've got going. And that's going to happen after church next Sunday. They kind of move the dates around just so they can get more people involved. And all they said is, you know, bring some cards and some postage stamps for those cards. Pack a lunch and bring something to drink. Hang out after church for an hour or so, make cards out to people that we need to reach out to, that you want to reach out to, that you want to send an encouraging message to. And that's kind of what that ministry for. And on their first round, I received a card, and it was very uplifting. So I know that is a ministry that is good. So plan on maybe next Sunday sticking around for a little bit, bring some cards, bring some stamps, bring a peanut butter and jelly sandwich and a little carton of milk. Kind of reminds you of your grade school days or something. But yeah, it's a good thing. So if you can, stick around for that. On the 20th, we have our annual members meeting. So that's kind of where we set our officers up, because the state says we have to every year, and we kind of look at what's going on for the current year going ahead. But it is Lottie Moon time. I'll give the guys a chance to cue up the video a little bit. But Lottie Moon is our foreign missions. Foreign just means that it's outside of the United States and North America for the most part, but really, it's just a chance for us to support those that are serving God around the world. You good? I think he's good. Watch a little video real quick. There we go. I'm sorry, Mary Jo, it is not closed caption.
Here in Thailand, there are so many people who don't know God, and no one they know knows God.
Thai people have a desperate desire to get rid of the sin that they know they have. They're going to the temples and they're taking money and gold and flowers and anything they can do that they think is good that might erase the sin that they know that is inside them.
Am I calling to be a doctor and calling to be a missionary came on the same day. When a missionary came and spoke at our church, he said the line, the saddest thing I've seen after 35 years on the mission field is children sick and dying because there's no doctor to care for them. And it was a lightning bolt through my soul. And I said, okay, God, I'll be a medical missionary. Our ministry here takes mobile clinics all over the country of Thailand. Church planners call me up and say, I'm trying to start a new church where there's never been one, would you come and help me? Medicine is just a means for me to share the gospel with those who have no other access. When I talk about how to take care of their physical needs, it's just so easy for them to see when I start talking about their soul that they need a savior as well. And American churches have partnered with me in that. And they have sent me short-term mission teams that come with me for about a week every month. And we go out and do mobile clinics all over the country. Without the churches coming alongside me, I cannot do what I do. In general, people here do not like talking about spiritual things. But on mobile clinic, we can talk to 100 people in a day, 200 people, 300 people in a day that will come to mobile clinic, and there we can share Christ with so many people at one time. It makes mobile clinic a great avenue for sharing the gospel. The point of mobile clinics is to start churches. Groups of Thai believers that will go on to grow people in their new faith, to disciple them in their understanding of who Christ is, and to grow them together into groups that will become churches. There's a lot of things that money can't buy. Being able to be here and see God praised where He has never been praised before, that is a dear joy. Seeing souls saved in areas where no one has ever known God before, watching them grow in their faith and lead others to faith, and watching them grow together into churches, seeing churches start where no one has ever worshiped God before. Money can't buy that.
I like that part in his message where he said that the mobile clinics are there to start churches. Think about that. What does the community need? Well, let's help God provide it. That's what he said. I saw that they had a need, and so I'm going to provide it. He could not do that alone. He even said that he has missionary teams that come in and help him. But think about that. The mobile clinic's purpose which most people think is, well, it's to heal them and to provide medicine and to, no. They start churches. And so that money comes from us. And so inside of your worship folder is that our Lottie Moon little envelope. And I'm getting ready to take up the offering, ushers, just so you know. This is not for your tithe. Your tithe goes in the normal check. This is for what you want to give to Lottie Moon. $1,600 is the goal this year. $1,600. I'm not asking you to give $1,600. Wow, if you can, that would be fantastic. I'm asking you to give a dollar, $2. That's all they're asking for. No one church is supporting that clinic all by itself. The Lottie Moon offering is. And so if you give a dollar and I give a dollar and a million other people give a dollar, guess what? That's $1 million. Right? I'm not asking you to give it all. I'm just asking you to give something. So when we take up the offering here, put your normal offering in, God uses that around here. The purpose of the food bank is not to give food to the people in this community. The purpose of Wednesday night dinners is not to give food to the community. The purpose of the food bank and the purpose of our Wednesday night dinners so we can show the love of God to the community. But if nobody shows that love, if nobody shows up for pantry, if nobody shows up for Wednesday night dinner, the community thinks God's love doesn't show up, right? So we're here. God has called us here. The community needs us here. Let's give, not just of money, but of our time, too. God calls us to serve. Get the ushers to come down. We'll go ahead and pray, take up the offering. Because I know God has been using it powerfully for the last, how long have we been here, 13, 14 years now? And it's not going to stop now just because maybe we're getting tired. So, dear Heavenly Father, I ask that you bless this time here. Not for our sake, but for the community's sake. Lord, let us refresh ourselves by worshiping you. Let us just pour our heart out into you and open our hearts up to your message. Lord, bless the offering that we are taking up. May it reach out not just into this community, but Lord, into the world. Let us find a way to show the world your love. For it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Jesus spoke to the people once more and said, I am the light of the world. If you follow me, you won't have to walk in darkness because you will have the light that leads to life.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you, hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God.
Well, today we get to do baby dedications, child dedications, whichever you want to call it. And we're going to do that in just a short while, but before we get there, I want to talk about family. I want to talk about family. You know, over the past half century or so, Hollywood has tried to use television to promote their concept of the perfect family, the ideal family. Now, this picture up here, some of you may recognize that. That's the Cleaver family from Leave It to Beaver. How many people remember that? Wow, there's a lot of old people in here. But the Cleaver family, you know, was a good nuclear family. I mean, both parents were present, the kids got themselves into trouble, but they learned to grow up with respect for their parents. Now, this next picture is the Brady family. And they began to stretch the definition of family as they blended two families together, though they still worked together through the pains and struggles of family. Then you get to the Bundy family of Married with Children. And there you find a general lack of respect that was prevalent in this family. It doesn't matter whether it was between the parents or if it was from the children. Then many of you were familiar with the Gilmore Girls, portrayed three generations in the Gilmore Girls, where the grandparents set impossible expectations that their daughter rebelled against, and the father of her child is only around in times of emergency, and both the daughter and her child are trying to figure out who's the right guy for each one of them. And then, most recently, TV has presented the Pritchett, Dumphy, Tucker clan in the show known as Modern Family. Now, in Modern Family, you've got an older man who married a young Latina, and it's pretty clear, at least to me, that it's all about physical attraction as they're raising two boys. Now, his daughter is married to a man who is portrayed as quite incompetent as plan after plan falls through for him. And their children are constantly scheming, using their various talents to see what they can get away with. And his son is a homosexual in a homosexual marriage, and they've adopted an Oriental daughter. Now, all this is portrayed by Hollywood in an effort to show these things as normal. But they're not. And they're certainly not ideal. So, who does the Bible depict as the ideal family? Well, it starts with Adam and Eve, and of course they committed the first sin, and then one of their sons commits murder. Then there's Abraham and Sarah, and Abraham tells Kings that his wife Sarah was his sister. I mean, he wasn't exactly lying, but Sarah gave Abraham her maidservant so that he could have kids. Then there was Isaac and Rebekah, and each of them had their favorite son, you know, Jacob and Esau, resulting in Jacob tricking Esau and then fleeing for his life. Then there was Jacob and Rachel, and also Jacob's other wives, Leah, Zilpah, and Bilhah, where the sibling rivalry got so bad that their youngest, Joseph, was sold off into slavery. And then we have King David, a man after God's own heart, who had multiple wives and even had an affair with Bathsheba. And then there was David's son, Solomon, who had 700 wives and 300 concubines. Now, I don't have a picture up here of it, but the prophet Hosea was commanded by God to marry a prostitute and then continue to pursue her even when she returned to her ways of the nightlife. Now, you would think Jesus, the Son of God, would have the ideal family. I mean, after all, he came to set the example, to live a life of perfection, and he died on our behalf. But his earthly father, Joseph, was out of the picture sometime after Jesus turned 12. And at one point, his mother and his brothers came to take him home because they thought he'd gone crazy with some kind of Messiah complex. So there is simply no example of a perfect family to be found, not even in the Bible. Why not? Well, I think that's part of the genius of God. I mean, he made families from imperfect people, and therefore families are imperfect. Now, that helps us to see that biblical accounts are authentic, they're genuine, and they're reliable, and they're relatable. God doesn't sugarcoat things, and he doesn't make his heroes out of perfect people, but he portrays them with all of their faults and all of their imperfections. There are, however, instructions for us imperfect people. There are instructions given for how we can strive for our families to become as ideal as possible. So even though the world has been trying to change our idea of what forms the ideal family, God's word doesn't change, and Paul gives us instructions for how to strive to have the best family. Please open your Bibles or your Bible apps to the book of Ephesians. Ephesians, and then find chapter 5. And for the time being, let's start with verse 22. Ephesians 5, verse 22. Familiar passage. Paul writes, "Wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands as you do to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is the Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church, without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In this way, this same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated their own body, but they fed and cared for their bodies just as Christ does the church. For we are members of his body. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united with his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I am talking about Christ and the church. However, each one of you also must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, so that it may go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on the earth. Fathers, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord." I think that's good enough for now. But if we're going to look at the ideal family, one of the things that we have to understand out of this scripture passage, we've got to look at this idea, this concept, this word, submit. I mean, we hear Ephesians chapter 5, 22. We read that where it says, you know, wives, submit yourselves to your husband. And the married men, especially the younger ones, you know, they secretly are cheering as their wives are just shaking their heads, thinking, ah, here we go again. And part of this reaction comes from how the people who translated the Bible into English added the verse numbers and the headings dividing up Scripture. And I want you to look again at this passage, but I want you to back up to the previous paragraph, you know, starting in verse 15. And between verse 15 and 21, 22, that you probably have a heading in your Bible or your Bible app. Mine says instructions for Christian households. But what I want you to do is I want to read that paragraph before, and I want to put your finger, if you have it open, on that heading that divides that up. Pretend like the heading isn't even there. Now, reading starting with chapter 5, verse 15, "Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another with psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit. Sing and make music from your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ." See, it's talking about everybody submitting, mutual submission. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. And then Paul continues in verse 22, where it goes into wives, you know, submit yourselves to your own husbands as you do to the Lord. But here's how unfortunate that heading placement is dividing up Scripture in this passage. Because the English word submit isn't in the Greek in verse 22 where it's talking about wives submitting. It's pulled down from verse 21 where Paul is commanding mutual submission. Now, if I was in a language arts class and I was asked to outline Paul's last portions of Scripture, you know, from where we read in chapter 5, verse 15 through the end of chapter 6, here's what I'd get. I put the outline up on the board here. That's the way it shakes out to me. It starts with being filled with the Spirit, not drunk on wine. And using music, you know, psalms, hymns, and songs. Why? Using the music to address each other, and also using the music to make melody to God. And then it goes into giving thanks to God for everything. And then it starts on submitting to one another. Submitting to one another. And that includes wives, husbands, children, fathers, employers, and employees. And then it closes up with suiting up with the armor of God. So looking this outline over, notice how the portion on submitting takes up at least half the outline. I believe it's because Paul knew how difficult this idea of submitting is for us as humans. It goes against our nature. We want to look out for our own interests, and to submit, that means we have to put someone else before ourselves. And yet Paul tells us that's exactly what we need to do, to put someone else before ourselves. In Philippians chapter 2, in verse 3 and 4, he says, "Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others." So Hollywood has given a poor portrayal of what it means to submit, especially for the wife to submit to her husband. For example, you know, some of you may remember Archie Bunker from All in the Family. You know, Archie would get home, he'd plop down in his chair, and he would order his wife Edith around. And she'd fall all over herself trying to make sure that his every need was met. Well, this misuse of the idea of submitting, mutual submission, has led to family strife. It's led to divorce. It's even led to abuse. But Paul draws a beautiful picture of how marriage is like the relationship between Christ and the church. And the overarching idea here of how a family can become more ideal, is mutual submission. The format for the word is a command that carries the idea that this is to be done willingly. In other words, there's a choice. You don't have to submit. You don't have to obey. But if you submit, it's by your choice, not by demand, not by command. Wives, submit to your husbands as unto the Lord. Why? Because the husband is the head of the wife, just as Christ is the head of the church. So how do we as a church look upon Jesus when he is the head of us? How do we look upon Jesus? Do we see him as some dictator constantly trying to control every aspect of our lives? No. We see a loving Savior who gave his very life for us. I mean, Jesus clearly has what's best for us at his heart. And it's easy to submit to someone when you see that about them. You know, back in the time when Paul was writing this, marriages were arranged. And after they were arranged and betrothed and married, they learned to love each other as husband and wife. Today, each man picks his wife. Each woman picks her husband. And so ladies, if you're not married yet, I want to encourage you to find a man that you can see this way, the way Jesus is. Seek someone that you know and trust to keep your best interests at heart. Husbands, love your wives. Why? Again, because Jesus is our example. He gave himself up for the church to prepare her to be the best bride possible. He sanctified and cleansed her so he could present himself with a perfect, holy bride. Men, I know that when we read to love as we love ourselves, in our culture that seems a little strange, it seems a little weird. But do you love yourselves? I mean, some of us may love ourselves a little too much. But if we're being honest, we have all these qualities, but some of the qualities are better than others. And we have room for improvement, without a doubt. But we still seek what's best for ourselves because we love ourselves. And it's the same with our wives. We seek what's best for her, even setting aside our own desires. We nurture, care, just as Jesus did for the church. Paul concludes this segment at the end of chapter 5 by quoting from Genesis and quoting from Matthew. In Genesis chapter 2, 24, he quoted, "That is why a man leaves his father and mother and is united with his wife, and they become one flesh." From the beginning of humanity, God defined marriage. Jesus reiterated that definition as he addressed divorce in Matthew. Husband and wife become one flesh, so we should submit to each other. Husbands, love your wives. Wives, respect your husbands. Husbands and wives work together for the glory of God. Then in chapter 6, Paul goes on to address children. It says, "Children, obey your parents. Honor your parents." Does that mean that children always have to agree with everything? No. Does that mean that children always have to like what the parents decide? No. Does that mean that children should always obey? Yes. If not, I think, you know, this command is the first command in the Bible that comes with a promise. And the promise is that obey, honor your parents so that it may go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on this earth. So if that is the command and that's the promise that goes with it, then what do you think disobeying that command would bring? What is the opposite of it may go well with you? It doesn't go well with you. I remember growing up, I can't remember exactly if it was at the end of middle school or the beginning of high school, but I remember one time I was at a friend's house. His name was Rick Boosinger. And we were there after school, and he was arguing with his mom in the kitchen about doing the dishes. And as he was carrying on, she stepped towards him, and inadvertently she stepped on the end of his sock. He didn't have his shoes on, but he has socks on, and she stepped on the end of his sock. And when he tried to step back, he lost his balance and he fell. Well, he broke his arm when he fell. Now, was that his mom's fault? No. It was his fault because he wasn't obeying. So how's it about when you honor your parents? I mean, when you do as you're asked, whether you like it or not, most of the time you get better results. In fact, as your parents see that you honor them, they may even listen when you have a differing viewpoint so that you can negotiate. Then Paul moves on to fathers, and actually, I think this goes for both parents when he says, "Fathers, do not exasperate your children. Don't provoke them to anger." Now, this isn't a statement that's saying that as a parent you need to be buddy-buddy with your child and give them everything that they think they need. I mean, we do them a disservice when we do this. Our children need us to be parents first, to provide discipline and guidance and instruction in the Lord. They need us to be reasonable in our expectations, to provide the boundaries that keep them safe as they're growing up, and to just provide consistency. And this consistency is what keeps us from provoking our kids to anger. Now, they may not always agree with us, but they tend to not be bitter as they get older because they saw the consistency in what we did, how we parent. So you want to strive for the ideal family? Well, it begins with your relationship with Jesus. A cord of three strands is not easily broken. It takes a husband, it takes a wife, and most importantly, it takes God to allow your family to become ideal. So, in a few minutes, we're going to do baby dedications, and we're going to transition a little bit. The AV team is going to play a music video. They're going to turn off Facebook for now. And we're going to take a few moments during the music video to greet one another with however you're comfortable. And then the kids are going to come up from downstairs. And when we come back, I would ask that the parents with their child to be dedicated come and sit on these front pews over here, okay? Go ahead.